Church, and welcome. We are so glad you're here. You may be here in spirit, but you're here, and we love you, and we miss you, and we look forward to seeing you again. So come and worship with us this morning.
Call.
are great, and we are so thankful that even in this time that we're going through, that you are still a great God, and we love you and we thank you so much.
You're already blessed already, huh? Already glad you woke up early and came to church on Sunday morning, huh? You know, it's funny how God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things. These last few weeks, actually months, you know, it's I don't know about you, but it's difficult for me sometimes because I'm trying to see where I fit in the puzzle. Trying to see where I fit in the scheme of things and how things are going on. And, you know, every day is a different day, and the sense of being normal is kind of gone already. You know, I went to the store to go get some, went to get some food, and they told me I had to pay at my card because they didn't have exact change because all of a sudden they stopped making pennies. I don't know, you know. Things are just changing. You got to get creative in how you're going to spend your money now, you know. I'm so glad that we have a God that's a creative God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 31. I mean, verse 1 through 30. I'm not going to read through 31. I'm going to read just a little bit short, shy of that. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And then God saw the light and saw it was good. Then he separated the light from the darkness. He called the light day, and he called the darkness night. And evening passed and morning came, making the first day. Then God said, "Let there be a space between the waters to separate the waters of the heavens from the waters on earth." And that's what happened. God made this space to separate the waters of the earth from the waters in the heavens, and God called that space sky. And God said, "Let the waters beneath the sky flow together into one place, so that dry ground may appear." And that is what happened. And God called the dry ground land, and the waters seas. And God saw it was good. Then God said, "Let the land sprout with vegetation, every sort of seed-bearing plant, and trees that grow bearing seeds of fruit. These seeds will then produce all kinds of plants and trees from which they came." And that is what happened. The land produced vegetation, all sorts of seed-bearing plants and trees and seed-bearing fruit. Their seeds produced plants and trees of the same kind. And God saw that it was good. There you go. And evening passed and morning came, making the third day. I'm going to fast forward a little bit. You know where it goes. Then it says in verse 26, God said, "Let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the seas and the birds in the sky, the livestock and all the wild animals on the earth, and all the small animals that scurry, mice, the things that you want to step on, and you know, when you see it in your yard or in your garage. All those things that scurry along the ground." Verse 27, "So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them." Heavenly Father, we thank you that you created us. We're thankful, Lord, that we did not come here, Lord, by any sort of chance, but by a pure, immaculate design. You created us. Not only did you create us, but you created us with the intention of walking with you. Lord, we take hold of that. We appreciate that. We love you for that. Lord, let us be the people that will live the creativity that you've breathed into us. Let that live through our lives so that we can connect our fellow brother and sister to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, when I read this, it reminds me that God is the most creative being in the universe. I remember times as a young man reading this scripture and times when I would have doubt whether I came from some type of evolving creature to being created like the Bible tells me I am. And I remember God told me one time, I was sitting out in my house and I was looking at the sky and I was praying, and God said, "Caesar, I created all of that." I said, "Yes, God, I know you did." He says, "Caesar, you think you're smart?" I go, "Yes, God, I think I'm smart." He says, "Caesar, you're dumb compared to me. Say, God, that didn't make me feel good. God says, Caesar, if you think you're so smart, close your eyes. Now imagine there being no universe. And I close my eyes and I try my best and all of my creative sense. And even as human beings, we try to close our eyes and try to imagine there being no universe. And we have a creator that created this universe. And we could create all kind of things, but we can't imagine there being not being a universe. Would it be the color black? Well, no. Would it be white? No. What would it be? And the reason is because you did not create this thing that you're living in. You have a creator. Who believes that this morning? Contradictory to what the world may tell you, contradictory to what your science teacher may have told you, you were created by a God. He's the architect of the universe. He created every animal, every creature. He created the seasons to move in perfect pattern. As a matter of fact, we talk about this global warming thing and how mankind is messing up the seasons. We're messing up what God created. It's amazing how the mountains that stand behind this church, up on these mountains, how there's clouds that move in a cycle that pour snow down and rain and snow down, and that snow stays on that mountain for a matter of months. And then when it gets time for that snow to melt, it begins to flow down through this valley to water our crops into the oceans. And it's a cycle. It didn't happen just to be that way. It wasn't just a roll of the dice. It was God who created that cycle. Even animals know this. We have a God that created us. And even with the walls that we're facing today, God created you. Even with the hardships you're going through, God created you. And as his child, when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, he downloads a creative spirit inside of you. You got to use it. You know, I brought this to you. Sean might have to zoom in on it. That's okay if he doesn't, but y'all can't see it, but that's okay because this is important to me. You can see it later. My wife and I went to the Charles M. Schulz Museum on February 14th. 2010. That was a Valentine's Day trip. Charles M. Schulz invented the Peanuts characters. Charlie Brown, wah, 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 wah. Tell your neighbor, say wah, 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 wah. And he invented Snoopy. So I go to the museum and they have a place where you can draw. And here I am as a grown man. I've never really drawn in my life. You know, I do music. I thought I was creative that way, but I didn't think I was creative when it comes to the drawing and etching. And here I am, and I get a picture of Snoopy sitting next to me, and I began to freehand a picture of Snoopy. And I take the picture of Snoopy, and there's a volunteer lady that's there, and I look to her. There's a lady in her 70s, sweet woman, you know, and I tell her, I said, ma'am, look. And I'm like a little kid. My wife is just staring at me, just smiling and cheesing, because I'm like a little boy. And she's all, I go, ma'am, look. Look what I did. I drew Snoopy. And I'm like, look at how good he looks. And my wife goes, yeah, baby, good job. I did a good job. And the lady, the volunteer, I show her, because I want to show everybody in the whole little class, look what I drew, look what I drew. Even now, this picture is on a magnet on our refrigerator. And I said, look at what I drew. And the volunteer looked at me, and she said, oh, how cute, you didn't draw that. I said, I did draw this. She goes, you didn't draw that. I did. And I went to my wife and go, baby, that lady said that I didn't draw this. Remember that, baby? And so I traced Snoopy just to prove that there's a trace. And my picture looks pretty good, you know, but compared to the actual tracing, he looks a little off. My Snoopy's head is a little lopsided. But you can tell it's Snoopy. I never thought I could draw. I never thought I was artsy. They call it artsy fartsy. I never thought I was artsy fartsy. You know, I probably was the person that would never go into Marion Brooks' class. I never thought I could be qualified to do that. Marion Brooks, her and her husband were one of the founders of this church. The stained glass windows, she designed those. And she had a class where she would teach people how to draw. And they would discover that they had a creativity in them that they never thought was there. After that Snoopy moment, I kind of got addicted to drawing and painting. My wife, we go to these couples painting classes all across the state, different places. And I painted a wave. And I was so proud. Y'all can honk for that one. We'll be auctioning this later. Just kidding. And I even put a little surfer on top of it. That was an extra. But you know, you're never going to know what you can do unless you step out of your comfort zone. And, you know, creativity, when you think of that, you think of just the arts. You think of music. You think of, you know, painting and drawing or sculpture. But creativity that God gives us is not just in the arts. That's one facet of it. But there's so many other ways that you could be creative. You could be creative in your ideas. You could be creative in how you approach situations. A strategist. Anyone know somebody who knows how to approach people in difficult situations and talk to them and get difficult points across? I'm learning that approach. Maybe, you know, you're creative in starting a business ideas. But creativity involves taking a risk. It's breaking the mold. You know, there's that quote, necessity is the mother of all invention. If you think about the stars in the sky, there was once a time that when people were lost, they would use the stars to navigate just to find out where they're going. You can still do that to this day. And then eventually someone said, you know what? I can invent a compass. And they use the compass now to find where the magnetic north is. God created the polar magnetism of this earth, and God created that. And we can use that tool to be able to help us so we're not lost. Then someone said, you know what? We're going to start making maps. And then they made maps, and someone invented a map, and people started using maps to get around. How many of us used to travel and used to have a big old map sprawled out across the dashboard of your car, trying to find out where you are and where you got to get to? How many of y'all got frustrated because you didn't know where you were on the map and how to get to where you had to get to, and you spent a lot of time being lost? Someone knew that was a problem, so they came up with a solution, and they invented a thing called a smartphone. And they put something on that smartphone called a GPS. Whoever used the GPS on the smartphone? I use it all the time. Whenever my wife gets mad at me, my smartphone tells me where to go. That was a joke. You don't got to honk on that. And if you don't know how to use your smartphone, guess what they have now? They have a person you could talk to on the smartphone called Siri. And you could just say, Siri, I need to go to the gas station. Siri will take you right to the gas station. All of these are creative ideas, creative tools to get you to where you got to get to in life. Business ideas. Think about, when I think of the gold rush, I think of John Sutter and how John Sutter, when you think of the gold rush, the first name I could think of is John Sutter. Do you know that guy wasn't a gold miner? Do you know what that guy did? Do you know what he did? He was smart. He sold supplies to the gold miners. And now there's hospitals and buildings and monuments to that man because he thought out of the box. You know, people who have lived through the Great Depression, they had to get creative on how they would make food. Think of ideas and how to get things done. Necessity is the mother of all invention. Well, there's a necessity right now in our world, and it's not for more money. It's not for the vaccine. The necessity is for hope, and that hope only comes through Jesus Christ. This is why people in church are so frustrated, because we have people saying, well, you can't do nothing in your church anymore, and it, you know, just stop. A shutdown mentality. How do I reach people with the gospel? You know, restaurants have come up with ideas. They've been creative in how they serve their food. Movie theaters have moved. People are going to drive-ins. Concerts have been doing outside in drive-ins. I watched a boxing match last night. Two boxers, you hear the crowd cheering, and I'm like, where's the crowd? All this blurry. It was pictures of crowds in the background. They piped in the sound of a crowd cheering, but really it was just two guys just pumbling their faces in a ring. AT&T Park or Oracle Park, the Giants are selling, I think, $100 tickets if you want to take a picture and have your cutout so you can actually be in the game. They'll put your cutout in the stadium. You would think they wouldn't charge $100. Maybe they cut the price for that one, you know. People are being creative of how to get the job done. Everybody say, get the job done. Tell your neighbor, say, get the job done. We put God in a box. And God is not even in a box. God never gave you a box. God says, what box are you talking about? We're talking about the same God that gave Noah instructions on how to build an ark. We're talking about the same God that gave Joshua the instructions on how to conquer a city. When you read the Battle of Jericho in Joshua chapter 6, verse 1 through 16, here they are in the land of the Canaanites, and God says, I'm going to give you Jericho. Jericho, he actually tells them, Jericho is yours. You go to verse 2, he says, I have given you Jericho, its king, and all of its strong warriors. He says, you and your fighting men should march around the town once a day for 6 days. Seven priests will walk ahead of the ark. What is so significant about the ark? The ark symbolizes the presence of God. See, they couldn't fight Jericho with their swords and their arrows. They couldn't fight Jericho with their might and their army because there was a big wall to separate them. But God said, listen, all you need to do is what I'm telling you. Follow my creative instructions. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to walk around. I don't know if you've ever heard of a war where God told people to walk around the enemy, maybe get their flank and attack it from the back. That sounds reasonable. But you mean you want me to walk around them all the way 360 degrees around my enemy? And God says, yes. Verse 4, seven priests will walk ahead of the ark, each carrying a ram's horn. On the seventh day, you will march around the town seven times with the priests blowing the horns. And when you hear the priests give one long blast of the ram's horns, have the people shout as loud as they can. Then the walls of the town will collapse, and the people can charge straight into the town. So Joshua called the priests and everyone and said, take up the ark of the Lord's covenant and assign seven priests to walk in front of it, each carrying a ram's horn. Then he gave orders to the people, march around the town, and the armed men will lead the way in front of the ark of the Lord. Here's what happens. I'm going to fast forward a little bit. In verse 12, Joshua got up early the next morning. And the priests again carried the ark of the Lord. Seven priests with the ram's horns marched in front of the ark, blowing their horns, following the creative instructions, okay, that God gave them. Keep reading. Again, the armed men marched both in front of the priests with the horns and behind the ark of the Lord. All this time, the priests were blowing their horns. On the second day, they marched around the town once and returned to the camp. They followed this pattern for 6 days. And then on the seventh day, everybody say the seventh day. On the seventh day, verse 15, the Israelites got up at dawn and marched around the town. And I can imagine doing this. I can imagine being in the army, and I can imagine the naysayer saying, what God is telling Joshua, is this really God or is this Joshua? Well, what does he mean, walk around? We look like idiots walking around. I mean, these are some of the thoughts I would have thought. This isn't how you fight a battle. This isn't how you take a city. You don't walk around it. You go and climb that wall. You bust the doors down. You do something. But you don't walk around and just make noises and blow horns. But on the seventh day, the Israelites got up at dawn, marched around the town as they had done before. But this time, they went around the town seven times. And on the seventh time around, the priests sounded the long blast of their horns. And Joshua commanded the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the town. When the people heard this, the sounds of the ram horns, they shouted as loud as they could. I'm fast forward to verse 20. Suddenly, the walls of Jericho collapsed. And the Israelites charged straight in the town and captured it. That is a powerful testimony of God's hand. This is not a made-up story. This is a historical fact of what had happened in the town of Jericho and how Jericho fell. And God told the people to shout. And when they shouted, the walls fell. You know, the Ark of the Covenant was with them. And like I said before, the Ark of the Covenant was a symbol. It had a significant importance to them. It symbolized that God was with them. The presence of God was with them. And when you have the presence of God with you, walls in your life will fall down. This is why we meet. You can honk. You can shout, church. This is why we meet. This is why we encourage one another. This is why we come together, because my Bible tells me where two or more are gathered in his name, that where is he at? He is in the midst. Church, God is out in the parking lot right now this morning, and he's commanding you to shout because you got victory in Jesus, and the walls in your life will fall down. What walls are in your life this morning? God says, shout. Shout against the wall because it will fall. You're not going to win with human ways. You're not going to win at the voting box. You're not going to win by stacking your money and hoarding and prepping. You're going to win by shouting to the Lord, calling out on him, meeting together, What walls are in your life this morning? Is it the walls of doubt that are in your life this morning? Doubt will fall in the name of Jesus. Depression, the walls of depression will fall in the name of Jesus. Difficult times will fall in the name of Jesus. Sickness in your body will fall in the name of Jesus. Are you experiencing lack right now? Lack will fall in the name of Jesus. Your marriage, the walls in your marriage between your wife and your husband, that wall that the devil has put up in your life, that wall will fall in the name of Jesus. Addictions in your life, alcoholism, drugs, pornography, those walls will fall in the name of Jesus. When God is with you, he'll give you power. He'll give you victory. You got to claim the trophy, church. Are you lonely this morning? The walls of loneliness will fall when you are in the presence of God. The walls of unforgiveness will fall when you are in the presence of God. Bitterness of things that have happened years and decades ago will fall. God will begin to bring healing from that pain in the presence of God. You got to be in God's presence. You see, the power of God comes from being in his presence. This is why the devil don't want you to come to church. This is why the devil wants you to be all stuck in your uncomfortableness of being in a hot parking lot rather than focusing on being in the presence of God. This is why the devil wants you to watch news from sunup to sundown instead of playing some worship music and some preaching in your house, because he wants you out of the presence of God. Stay away from the shutdown mentality. You see, the power of God is not restricted by the stock market. The power of God works before and after November 4th. Come on, somebody. The power of God is not determined by the unemployment rate or the real estate market. The power of God doesn't determine on whether the government is saying yes to God or not. Your government may shut down time and time again, but the Holy Spirit never shuts down. Your local businesses may be closed, but the church of God is always open for business. And God is working remotely. Everybody say, God's working remotely. What does that mean, preacher? What that means is that church business as usual has changed. The methods have changed, but the message stays the same. When God works remotely, that means he works through you. You in your car. You watching online. God desires to work remotely through you. He wants you to preach through the way you live your life and the way that you speak. He wants you to bring the truth to a world that's in need, that's bought lies. He wants to work through you. So, church, with that being said, will you allow him? Well, Pastor, I don't know how to do outreach. You may have a shortage of ideas, but God doesn't. He will give you ideas on how to minister in the world we live in today. Our church, we have youth ministry that's still going on every week. Our church, we have people in our church that are starting Bible studies in the parking lot early in the morning. Our church is coming up with ideas on how to serve communion and how to baptize. Our church is coming up with ideas on how to have an outdoor platform to have church. God is no shortage of ideas. He's a creative God. And when you're in his presence, he will give you ideas on how to do what he's called you to do. Stay away from the shutdown mentality. Stay in his presence. Romans 12:2, do not conform to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind. What mentality are you lending yourself to today? Avoid this mentality of shutting down. Say yes to the Lord. Yes to the creative mentality. We have a creative God, and he's deposited. When you're filled with the Holy Ghost, he's deposited that creativity inside of you. Begin to look and pray for ideas. Stay determined. Don't get discouraged if your idea doesn't work at first. Maybe you're called to step out in ways like leading bingo on bingo night. Maybe you're called to step out and pray, and you've never prayed out loud before. God is speaking to you because he's speaking to all of us to step out in areas we've never stepped out before. That's a beautiful thing. Don't be afraid. I know in the past you may have been discouraged. I know in the past people may have tried to shoot you down. I know in the past people have done to you like that lady did to me when I drew Snoopy. They'll try to discredit you. That's the enemy. That's the devil. You take charge and you say, I got victory in the name of Jesus. Look for ideas. Steal ideas from other churches. I don't want to call it stealing, but you know what I mean. Google some ideas of how to do outreach. Ask around. What's happening right now is God is revealing in our hearts where we really are. You know, Jericho was theirs, but they still had to walk around and be obedient to God. They had to be obedient to God's creativity. I've never heard of a battle where God told people to walk around the city and the walls just fell. It sounds ludicrous when you think about it. But it's not ludicrous when God says that's the way to go. Amen? So as a church, here's what we're doing. We're focused. We're not stopping. We're staying away from the shutdown mentality. We're just asking God, God, how? We're asking God, how? How's it going to get done? Because God, we know it's going to get done. But how, God? And God's going to speak to us. If you got ideas, talk to me. I want to hear your ideas. You got some thoughts? Hit me up with those thoughts. We're going to keep pushing. We had an idea to do prayer online. People do prayer online. They're like, man, it's great. And then I got some people say, I don't want to do prayer online. I don't want to push the button. One button. I'm too old. We got a man and a woman that's in their 80s. Every Wednesday, they in prayer. They had some technical difficulties at first, but they're with us every Wednesday in prayer. Stay in the presence of God. Amen? I'm going to close with this, and we're going to take our communion. So have your communion ready to go. You know, right now, this moment is revealing our hearts. Our hearts are being revealed of where we really are. There are people that are choosing not to come to church or not watching online. And the truth is that probably because in their heart, they really aren't even saved. Or maybe they're just discouraged. But this is a moment that's revealing where we really are. There are people right now that are just taking this moment as a vacation from Christianity. And then there's other people that are taking this moment, they're looking as the opportunity to evangelize, opportunity to disciple. Do you have a heart to really follow God? Or do you just have a heart to be a traditional Christian? Do you have a heart to really step out of your comfort zone and do some things you've never done before, to step in an area you've never stepped in before and really trust God? Do you have a heart to want to be in His presence throughout the week and let Him speak to you in creative ways that He'll use you? Our God is a creative God, and Jesus was the most creative leader that I've ever known. He spoke in parables. So those who didn't need to know, didn't know, and those who needed to know, got to know. He used symbolism to remind us, and one of the symbols He used was communion. You have your communion cup ready? You can open the package. Every time we receive the communion, we're reminded of what our Savior did for us. We're reminded that without Jesus, there is no hope. And without Jesus, there's no heaven. There's no healing. There's no direction. There's no peace. With Jesus, we have all of those great things. And not only does He offer His life, because see, sin is what separates us from God. And the only way that we could be connected is a sacrifice. And we sacrifice animals. Mankind did that for many, many years. Until there was an ultimate sacrifice, and that was God's Son, Jesus Christ. He lived a blameless life. He set an example of how we are to live. He taught us how to live. He taught us how to pray. Not only did He do that, but He died on the cross. And when He died on the cross, He thought of you. When He died on the cross, He thought about 2020. When He died on the cross, He knew that all this was going to happen. And that same Jesus was buried for 3 days, resurrected, and He sits in heaven, but He sent us a helpmate. He sent us the Holy Spirit to fill us, to direct us, the presence of God within us. I need the presence of God. Do you need the presence of God? Have you opened that gift of Jesus Christ? Have you asked Him into your heart? Have you repented from the sin in your life and turned away from those wrong ways and made a decision to follow Jesus? He doesn't want converts. He wants followers, disciples, people that will follow Him to death. the ultimate creator gave us Jesus, and Jesus, the ultimate creative leader, God in the flesh, said, sat down with his disciples, and they got ready on Passover to break the bread and drink the wine. Before we do this today, if you do not know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, now is the time to get right with God. If you don't know if you were to die, if you'd go to heaven or hell, I wouldn't want to live with that uncertainty in my life. You could be certain before you leave here today. So we're going to pray this morning before we receive the communion. And if you say this prayer, it's not a magical little thing when you say the words. You truly have to believe it. This is something you're speaking to God. So maybe you've said it over and over again, but maybe this is the first time. This is the time we're going to pray together. I'm asking you to repeat after me. Dear God, I know that you created the heavens and the earth, the universe. And I know that you created me. And I know that you want nothing more than to walk in communion, to walk with me throughout life. You walked with Adam and Eve, but their sin separated you from them. God, I have sinned. God, I have done wrong things against you. And I know the wages of sin is death, and Lord, I do not want to die. I want to be alive. So today I commit to following you. I ask that you forgive me from my sin. I repent and turn away from it. And today I make a commitment to following you the rest of my life. I believe that Jesus died on the cross for me. I believe he is the Son of God. I believe that he resurrected 3 days later. And I believe that when he died on the cross, he thought of me today. So this day forward, I commit this life to you. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. I want everything that is of you, your gifts and your fruit, I want that to display in my life. I want to grow in you and be discipled. In Jesus' name, amen. You said that prayer, whether it's for the first time or maybe not, maybe you rededicated. I want to talk to you. I want to pray with you. I want to encourage you. This moment that we receive the bread and the cup, we remember it. We remember what Jesus had done for us. Matthew 26. As they were eating, Jesus took some of the bread and blessed it. And then he broke it in pieces and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it, for this is my body. Let's receive the bread. And he took the cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink from it, for this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Mark my words, I will not drink wine again until the day that I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Let us receive the cup this morning. As the worship team comes up, let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us for our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will see the goodness of God. Come on, lift your hands. All my life, God. And all my life, you have been faithful. And all my life, you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love your voice.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire.
In the darkest night.
In the darkest night. You are close like no one.
I've known you as a father.
I've known you as a father.
I've known you as a friend.
I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness. So good.